the Ganesh Devi, who is an intellectual who has kept the political question alive in the modern tradition, actually, of, you might say, Gandhi and Lohia, who took Indian languages seriously for creating knowledge about ourselves. However dangerous it may seem to frame it this way, it's a question worth keeping on at the center of things, and he's done it in his own way. I hope the conversation will illustrate a few aspects of it. But to begin, more conventionally, before the Ganesh Devi of language activism and the book that she mentioned, as a PhD student, he worked in Aurobindo's poetry, the aesthetics and poetics in Aurobindo's work, which he finished in 1977 with Shantini Desai, who is an important Canada writer, in Kolhapur. After which he had the master's in Anglo-Irish poetry, and then he started teaching in Kolhapur. But before that, can you say a bit about what your concerns were in your dissertation?
मैं ये कहना चाहता हूँ कि मेरे दो तीन मुश्किलें हैं. सबसे पहली मुश्किल तो ये है कि I don't know anything about myself. I have information, but not knowledge about myself. दूसरा ये है कि मैं शायद एम्प्टी स्पेस हूँ और समय समय में कोई मुझे पजेस करता है और मैं उस खुद को सरेंडर करता हूँ और उसमें जो हो जाता है वो हो जाता है. उसका जिम्मेवारी मैं बहुत लेता नहीं हूँ. आई मीन इरिस्पॉन्सिबल इंटेलेक्चुअल, रेकलेस एंड इरिस्पॉन्सिबल इंटेलेक्चुअल. और तीसरा है कि अपने बारे में मैं अंग्रेजी में बहुत ऑथेंटिकली कुछ बोल नहीं सकता. इसलिए मैं आपको प्रॉमिस करता हूँ कि ये नेक्स्ट 35 मिनट्स में मैं अंग्रेजी में ही बात करूँगा, लेकिन कितना ऑथेंटिक होगा उसका गारंटी देने की जिम्मेवारी मेरी नहीं. सो अबाउट श्री अरविंदो, यू नो व्हाट अट्रैक्टेड मी टू अरविंदो वाज one simple biographical fact of that man. Here is a man who actually started the Swadeshi movement in 1905, the division of Bengal, Vanga Bang. Aurobindo was in Baroda. He plunged into politics. Then after a couple of years, he rushed to Calcutta to become principal of the National College, which has now become Jadavpur University, established by his elder brother Manmohan Ghosh. And he was the first one to give space to D.D. Kosambi's father, Dharmanand Kosambi, to give lectures on Buddhism. This man, when India became independent on 15th August 1947, like another person whom I admire immensely, despite what a people say about him, that is Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. Like Mohandas Gandhi, Arvind Ghosh on 15th August 1947 was not in Delhi. He started something. He was in Pondicherry. No newspaper in India on the 16th of August 1947 carried even one line report on what Aurobindo feels about Indian independence or Gandhi feels about Indian independence. I liked about Aurobindo his detachment from the tree for which he had sown the seeds. And as a young man, I was very impressionable, I should say. So I thought, here is a person on whom I should do some work. So I worked on his aesthetics. And his, by aesthetics, I don't mean just his ideas of what poem is, poetry is. He was very learned, Latin, Greek. He knew Italian, Spanish. He knew Italian and French almost as efficiently as his mother tongue, which he did not have. He knew some Gujarati, Tamil. He knew a little Bangla. because his parents had kept him away from learning Bengali. But he spoke of aesthetics as aesthesis, that is what the senses experience of this world, which means his aesthetics was about the human experience of the world, the totality of human experience of the world. And it was not just the experience of literature. And I think I failed for it. I feel fascinated by that. And he talks a lot about the future to come and so on, not as an astrologer's prediction, but as a philosopher's conceptualization. I somehow think that we have not done enough justice to this man, his production, literary and non-literary production. And so in the 70s it was English studies were generally moving away from study of Milton and Shakespeare and T.S. Eliot. So I thought I will work on Sri Aurobindo. It was tiresome because Aurobindo does not stop any sentence on the same page. Transformed to the next page as a rule. But I think when I was reading Aurobindo for my PhD thesis, I forgot my age. I forgot that I was in my 20s. I read Aurobindo like people would read him at the age of 60 or 70. And since I don't have a self, and you know, sometimes different ghosts possess me, that time a 60 or 70 year old ghost had possessed me, and I could do my PhD. I passed it in the first attempt.
You taught at Baroda for a very long time, 15 years, and in which you wrote your first, after Amnesia came, when you were teaching there. Can you reflect on your classroom experiences of being a teacher in English, in the English department, but concerns about Bhasha literature and how a certain memory had been erased by colonialism and other pieces of your book? How was doing English literature for you?
So I went to Baroda. I was in Kolhapur. And Kolhapur is a lovely town. Sugar cane, jaggery, bahut gali galosh karna, goats kaake, bahut meat khana. Kolhapur is fabulous. I loved it. And also I fell in love with a very beautiful woman. I got married there and all that happened in Kolhapur. I had a wonderful teacher there. But I thought I should go to Baroda, because Aurobindo used to teach at Baroda. Before he joined politics, he worked in Baroda College of the Sayajirao Gaikwad from 1893 to 1907, 14 or 15 years. So I thought I should go and teach there. And I had heard of two artists from Baroda. One was a literary artist, a man called Suresh Joshi. His writing I admired. And I had heard of a painter called Ghulam Ahmad Sheikh, whose paintings I admired. So I thought that would be a good company. They did not know me. But I have been reckless in my life, all three. And so I packed my bag at Kolhapur and went to Baroda with 7,000 rupees in my pocket as my ancestral, you know, property. The first day I went to Suresh Joshi's room. He was professor of Gujarati, about to retire. And I said in Marathi to him, "Mala Gujarati shikayache." So he said, "You come to me every day from 2 to 4, and he started teaching me Gujarati, which was a very rare honor, because people in Gujarati literature used to be terribly scared of meeting this man. He was very sharp in criticism, and he was frighteningly outspoken. So Sheikh and Suresh Joshi became great company for me. Upen Kakkar was there. Jyoti Bhatt was. Baroda was a Mecca for the arts. I say was, as that verb is used in the past tense in standard English. It is now finished. I taught in the Department of English, because I did not teach much. I was employed in the Department of English. I was an irresponsible teacher, and as a result of my work, Some of my students have become very illustrated, very outstanding, like Trindeep Suru, Jyotirmay Sharma, Sachin Kekar. Extremely outstanding group of students. Because I decided that I would draw the salary but not teach, which is possible in the university system. And I found many excuses for doing that. But in those days, I had a running quarrel with Suresh Joshi. And I thought I would write down my disagreement with him. Because he was all with Kafka, Camus, and whom I admire. But I was more with Venkatesh Madhulkar and U.R. Anant Murthy or Tejasvi Purnachandra, if you like, some example. So I thought I would write about this. So I started writing notes. He passed away. I don't say there's any relationship between the humor that I was writing notes, but very tragically he passed away suddenly, and my notes remained with me. So I did not know what to do. Then I sent them off to Sujit Mukherjee. Now Sujit Mukherjee's name, some of you might know of him. He said in his, he was a man with an impeccable sense of humor. I think the British should learn humor from Sujit Mukherjee. Such great was his sense of humor. Very civilized. He said, I will not read your notes unless you offer this as a manuscript to my publishing company. He was associated with a publishing company. So I said, I don't mind. It was half written. I completed the last. Then I got involved in a court case against the university. And I used to go to the court every day, and there were many typists typing.
Over what?
Injustice. You know, I get angry normally when I see injustice in the society. Otherwise, I don't get angry. So I was angry at that time for some injustice. And we had gone through, a bunch of writers had gone through hunger pass and all that. And I went to the court. And those many people used to sit there and type on the Remington typewriter under trees. These were the court typists. So I thought, why don't I take my typewriter as I am waiting for the judge to call me? And I went to the typewriter and completed the last chapter of what eventually became a book. When it was published, I had no hope that anybody would ever read it. It was completely on an esoteric subject, like the Marathi literary criticism and Gujarati literary criticism, who would read it? But because the cover designer had done a completely crazy, you know, I still don't understand the meaning of what she said, but that sold. And the title, Sudhir Kakkar told me, I think, your title sounds like name of a medicine, after amnesia, like after headache, after the first delivery. So I said, then, you know, it's good, it will sell like pharmacy. It sold, it received reviews. And even Meenakshi Mukherjee wrote it. That was a great compliment. And then it got a Sahitya Academy Award. The Sahitya Academy Award came to me when I was pretty young, very young.
It's okay.
And it came easy. And therefore, when I eventually returned it 25 years later, there was not much personal pain. It was returned because of somebody else's pain. But there was no personal pain in my heart when I returned it, because it had come a little easy.
Since you started the Bhasha Academy in 96, gave you a job, how, if you can recognize, it's tough to say when your interest awakens, but your interest in tribal life and society, how did that emerge?
In 1971, the census was done, and the reports of the census started appearing in 72, 73, up to 76. This is the time when I was reading for my MA, preparing for PhD, and I saw those reports. Now, I had no business to look at the census reports. I was to work on Aurobindo's mysticism, but I was interested, and for some reason I saw those reports. In those reports, I saw something terribly frightening, and that was in 1961 census, there was a mention of 1652 mother tongues, but in 71 census there was a list of only 108 mother tongues. There was one more entry, 109th, which read all others. Now I decided to get interested in this all others. mean, if you ask me what is my occupation, as people say, I'm a doctor, I'm a lawyer, my occupation is all others. That's what I've done in the entire, all of my life. These all others, I said, where have they gone? Which are these languages? Where on the map of India are they? And then I noticed that most of these others, the concealed mother tongues, where, I mean, supposing you were to do a straight line from Howrah to Surat on the map of India, 200 kilometers north of it or 200 kilometers south of it, entire tribal belt of India. Now, this did not shatter me, this geographical realization. But what it did was create a great curiosity in my mind as to why, please don't shoot the next word, why the hell, you can now start shooting. Why the hell Indo-Aryan languages and Dravidic languages, despite being together in the same subcontinent, have not come together over the last 4,000 years? I mean, it's another thing that some European linguist comes and tells us, you are Indo-Aryan languages, you are Dravidic languages, but the folks have been together, producing things, doing things. So I thought this middle part, now supposing you look at the flag of India, you have in the middle a colorless, white colored, you have, you know, green but white. I was interested in that white, the middle of India, the powerful area which could keep the Dravidic and the Indo-Aryan separate. So I wanted to test, I wanted to understand the power of these tongues. These are the ones who did not get colonized at all. They remained outside of colonialism. They suffered because of colonialism. This is a long story, but I'll make it short. The Germans created their navy, and therefore they created their forest department to have timber to build ships, basically. The British in retaliation created a forest department to build their navy, but they created the forest department not in England, but in India, since England does not have land. So the British forest department was created in India, and the communities in that region were named tribal communities. They had no kings to sign treaties with, and so these unsigned praja, subject, became tribals. These are the people with a different and far more advanced civilization than the rest of us have. And I'm saying this as a responsible anthropologist. So I felt drawn to them. I thought voice should be given to them. I should go to them and learn from them. And therefore I left the university. I had a salary from the university. But my wife, Sudekha, said that if you want to leave the job, then she would buy grocery at home. And so I could leave my job, go to tribals, settle in the Deshgarh village, create that tribal academy, get to know the nomadic and the denotified communities, meet exciting people like Ramdayal Munda and Mahashweta Devi, work with them. So all of that I did because I think for those 15 years I was angry to see the injustice caused there. But I did not want to promote violence. I do not think violence brings about anything desirable. It generates only counter-violence. The counter-violence from the state is far more deadlier. And therefore, I did not want to promote adjustment, mainstreaming them. Therefore, I said, it is time for the rest of the world to know who these people are, to learn from them. Therefore, I participated in creating tribal platform and a tribal perspective of the world. I was not an anthropologist who took my perspective to study tribals. I went there to see how tribals study the world, how their knowledge is valued, how their values are valued. So I am I am several times blessed that I could spend so many years with the tribals. I would suggest to the UGC, if the UGC is allowed to survive, because there is talk of demolishing it. If it is allowed, I would recommend to UGC wholeheartedly.
Lovely structure. Absolutely beautiful. What are the difficulties of setting it up? Who stood by you? How did you manage to raise the resources?
See, there were twice there were attempts on my life. वो सुना है आपने एक अमिताभ बच्चन बच्चों को गाना कि फिर शेर आ गया फिर क्या हो गया चाचू को बिकॉज ही जिंदा एंड स्टिल सिंगिंग द शेर डिड नॉट ईट हिम सो व्हाइल देयर वर अटेम्प्ट्स ऑन माय लाइफ आई सर्वाइव्ड आई वांटेड टू सी इट आई एम हियर यू कैन टच वेरी मच हियर द डिफिकल्टीज वेयर सो लॉन्ग एज आई वाज डीलिंग विद द आर्ट्स फोकलोर there was only joy. But a former governor of the Reserve Bank, I.G. Patel, I don't know this name, maybe some remember, he used to sign on our notes. He told me once, the moment you touch an economic issue, politicians will pounce on you. And that happened, I started microcredit there. I started a healthcare system. The healthcare system runs on insurance. That is, every tribal family pays 50 rupees, now 100 rupees every year, and we take care of the entire family medical needs throughout the year. And there are nearly 3 lakh tribals have benefited this their own medicine, not dependent on the government. The moment I started economic measures like seed bank, microcredit, healthcare, and things like that. The politicians started depicting me as, I mean, we talk of trolls. In tribal area, it is not trolling through internet. It is through rumors. And in rural India, some of your raids, Vilal Shukra's Rag Darbari, that's a great forerunner to modern day trolling, actually. You are defamed. Now, before my time, there was a great Gandhian activist in that area on the border of Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat. And he was trolled by the tribals, politicians, character assassination. So I decided one thing that, please pardon me for what I am saying, but I am only telling you the truth. I shall not talk to a woman when I am alone, only in somebody's presence. This I have to follow as a rule so that my word does not get destroyed. Even with my wife, you know, I would not, I decided that I will not take medicine so long as tribals don't get medicine. So I stopped taking medicine, even when I suffered from a snake bite. They said, you know, the long thing came and beat me here at the toe. Then I telephoned my wife, Suheka. That's her name. I said, saap aake kaata hai, main kya abhi dawai nahi leni hai. So she said, and hats off to her, she said, since it is your decision, don't take medicine. I don't know if she was disappointed or happy. So the experience was a great anger from government, a great ferocity from the politicians, but in compensation, limitless love and affection from the Adivasis. I cannot describe in words how much they felt comfortable with me. Even today, on those 2,200 villages where I worked, if I were to spend 1 or 2 days in every village, I would get absolutely free royal hospitality for the other experience was, I kept becoming angrier by the day, because despite telling the governments and all kinds of governments, it's not just this or that shape, they are not interested in tribals. And more than that, pardon me for saying this, the comfortable, not everybody in cities is comfortable. because there's not enough air, enough water and all that. But from the perspective of an economist, a comfortable middle class had the worst kind of apathy to tribals. For them, tribals are subject on which movies can be made or plays can be written, or one can sympathize with tribals so that one's own, you know, sense of security is set. So I was becoming angry. I knew that a huge continent of civilization is being destroyed before our very eyes, and nobody is interested in keeping it, respecting it. So that was my experience. Was it difficult? It was not difficult, it was just natural. This had happened to many railwaymen before me, and it will happen to many others after me.
Linguistic Survey of India that you did, before that you had a team of other researchers. You call it a rights-based language survey. So how is this different from the survey that the census normally does? And it is clearly different because you are unhappy with existing methods.
Well, in the Constitution of India, the very first page is fundamental rights, freedom of expression. So, supposing you are given the freedom of expression, but I say, you have the freedom of expression, but you should not use your language. That is taking away the freedom of expression which is there in the Constitution. In our education policy, there is no provision for teaching tribal children in their own languages. Now the question is, can we afford to teach in 100 or 200 different languages? My answer is yes, we can. It will be much cheaper because you can recruit teachers locally. But even if it is not cheaper, it's terribly expensive, still we need to do it. Because language is the primary citizenship right. Language alone makes us distinct from other animal species. Other animal species have hunger, desire to reproduce, fear of falling, or fear of death, falling from height. We have those, but we have this complex kind of language which enables us to get into each other's heads. The human brain is a recursive brain, and therefore I can think about what is going on in your heads just now. Just as you can think of what, you can reflect on my thoughts, I can reflect on your thoughts, because we have evolved complex language. In absence of such complex, semantically complex language, this recursiveness of the brain would be completely wasted. Now, I thought, because language has such fundamental position in human life, saving of languages of every community should be seen as the right of the community and not as some ke bahut dur se sadhu mara jaye the unhone hamara bhasha kaagaz kiya. That is, we are not obliging anybody. It is their right. And therefore, in the linguistic survey, apart from having just linguists, I had school teachers, shopkeepers, bus drivers, farmers, stark illiterate people. I will tell you. The highway, when you go to the toll, sometimes you see transgenders begging for alms, collecting some. Ab unki bhasha hai, it's a special language, it's called Koti language. I had long conversations with them about the Koti language, what is its grammar, syntax, whatever. With the nomadic communities like the bearers. Now people are scared of meeting bearers because they are known to hack you and look. That is a stereotype. Aisa kuch hota nahi. That's what we imagined. I have spoken to them. So some. Please, they are not thieves. Wrongly known as thieves, have given their words related to how theft is to be caused. Now that is at the risk of their profession. It's almost like politicians telling you what the strategy will be next election, or how much Safed Dhan they have got. So, at risk, people participated. And it was a very large team, 3,500. Totally 92 books will be published. About 45 are already out. And now that the team was built, the training was done, the field work is complete, the desk work is complete, it's only the publisher and the final ante samskar, as we call it, the last tinkering, the last sophistication is being provided in terms of copyrights, copy editing and characterization. All, by 2020 all the 92 books will be out, and that will be something that India can actually feel proud about. That people have done this. I have not done it.
What language should it be? Many languages.
Well, for every state there is a volume in English. For every state there is a volume in Hindi. And for every state there is a volume in the state language. For Meghalaya, there is a volume in Khasi and Garo already published. The English volume is published. Now the Hindi translation is on. For Karnataka, the Kannada volume is out. English and the Hindi will come up. For Maharashtra, Marathi, Hindi, English. In addition to that, there are volumes related on national issues like the languages of Indian language in diaspora, language policy in India, sign language, the English and Sanskrit and Hindi, because they don't belong to any particular state. So then the future of Indian languages. So they are for the national volumes. There are 50 volumes, 92 books, 35,000 printed pages, and the royalties go to Bhasha Center. So I am very happy, because you had asked in the earlier question what difficulties. I decided that my organization will always have funding from government which is not more than 5%. 95% funding I used to raise myself. Now that I become old, my shoulders are not so broad, so the responsibility is given to some others. But to run the organization, you need broad shoulders. Chest kitna bhi, let it not be 55+. But shoulders have to be broad. Otherwise, you end up, and if shoulders chote ho gaya aur dusra sab bada ho, you end up destroying institutions, as it happens, you know.
Your new book is called Crisis Within, Knowledge and Education in India. And I took a quick look at it. It says you're trying to talk about education appropriate for India. Question is, what is that, and has your sense for the crisis changed for the book or your career? Because you've been thinking about the problems for a while.
What is knowledge is, in the ultimate analysis, many layers of memory put one upon another. Several generational memories come together and then find institutional forms such as museum, library or university. Now, societies have unique ways of handling memory traditions. In the West, this tradition of handling memory came at one point in time to an obsession for classification, taxonomies, in the 16th and the 17th century. Memory is related to plants, birds, materials, all fell into chemical, you know, periodic table, zoological taxonomy, botanical taxonomy. These are ways of abstraction of memory, and the Europe actually evolved an abstraction of all abstractions when Leibniz decided that everything can be remembered with the help of symbols coined in combination of 0 and 1. This method of combining these abstractions of abstractions allowed the European mind access to any segment of what they call knowledge. And that this was called the universal science, because the access was universal. It was not science about the universe. When they hardly knew what was there beyond Liverpool at that time. But universal science is universal access to what exists as science. This was one way of handling memory tradition on our side, memory tradition, smruti parampara, was in terms sorted out in terms of intuitive interaction. Intuition of the guru and the intuition of shishya interacted. The shishya knew the guru is perfect and the guru knew that shishya is okay. This was one tradition. There was a second tradition of memory, and this is the tradition of the folks, the people who work with their hands, women. Our canonized memory tradition was this smruti thing, but there was a huge tradition of non-canonized knowledge. In India, the caste system excluded the non-canonized knowledge from knowledge. It did not give dignity of knowledge to the non-canonized memory tradition. This was one wound that the body of knowledge in India suffered from. The second wound was when during the colonial encounter, we came in confrontation with the Western tradition of memory. We could not reconcile the two. We tried our very best. I mean, most thinkers on education in the last two centuries have tried to figure out how to bring the Western knowledge and Indian knowledge together. Dayakrishna said, you know, held big seminar, how to bring rasa theory with Mimesis theory, how to apply rasa to Shakespeare and Mimesis to Kalidas. It cannot happen because the foundational cornerstones are different, made differently. I thought in our education today there's a great deprivation. You know, I don't talk about the institutional decay, that's a famous quote. But just consider this, ladies and gentlemen, that out of 130 crores of Indian population, 65 crores are young who actually need to be served knowledge. It is their birthright. We are not able to do that. There's great amount of exclusion, pathos, misery, poverty, and injustice, which as a student of language and literature makes me angry. If I don't become angry, all my praise of T.S. Eliot and Kalidas and Shakespeare is the useless kachra. If I don't feel angry at somebody suffering, my love for literature is false. I feel angry because it is genuine love for literature. I thought to go beyond these fractured memory traditions, we can find some space in the times of artificial memory. Because the human mind today is trying to push memory out of the brain as its natural function. We have outsourced the function of storing memory to some equipment. The brain in its present evolutionary development is trying to perform some other functions, higher functions, and therefore moving very rapidly towards visual image. Our languages will soon disappear. Soon, when I say soon, maybe in 3-4 centuries, 5 centuries, human languages as we know will have gone. Out of 6,000 natural languages, more than 4,000 languages are about to die in the next 30 years. This is scientific, I mean, not my opinion. It is widely held opinion among linguists. So the human brain is moving to a different kind of existence where we can go beyond the present time frames. Abhi kya hai bhasha mein, you have got past tense, future tense, present tense. Duniya ka jitna bhi aakalan hai, usi past tense, present tense, future tense mein hota hai. We arrest the world in our time frames. I think the human mind wants to get beyond this time frame for a multiplanetary existence where our sense of time and space make no sense at all. Abhi yahan se mangal pe jaye ya shukr pe jaye to wahan aaj budhwar hai, aaj mahine ka chautha din hai. It makes no sense at all. The mind will have to capture a space and a sequence, I will not say time, a sequence which is beyond what the human mind has so far captured, and therefore the brain is trying to acquire higher functionality and reducing, therefore deliberately reducing the burden of memory, giving it to artificial chip. Jaise humne kapda banane ka kaam haath se karte the, machine ko diya. I don't praise machines, I am only describing this neutrally. Makan banane ka kaam machine ko de diya, haath se nahi karte. Cement hum haath se nahi karte, pehle karte the, machine karte. So memory is remembered. Recollection as a function is given to that chip, and let's not be pretentious about it. All of us have forgotten memory. No, there's nobody here without a mobile phone. I mean, 20-40 साल पहले मुझे 40-50 टेलीफोन नंबर में बॉम्बे में जाता था 50 टेलीफोन नंबर याद, मद्रास में जाता था 50 टेलीफोन नंबर दिमाग में होते. Just now I am not able to remember my daughter's telephone number. मैं कभी-कभी खुद का नंबर भी मुझे लिख के रखना पड़ता. Because the brain is evolving. It's not a failure. It's an accomplishment. That space now, artificial memory, will help us to put up great challenges to the caste divide in terms of memory traditions and the universal science, which already Europe has started discarding in a big way. Lyotard, Lyotard has said that no longer knowledge will be there in terms of analogies, it will be in paralogies, there will be no knowledge but knowledges. So my book, The Crisis Within, is about what is the opportunity for us to go beyond the caste divide, to go beyond self and the other, like East and the West divide. How can we think as universal minds? How can we think beyond the earth consciousness and protect the earth, therefore, and belong to the earth in that sense? Belong to the earth. Tribals always know that they belong to the earth does not belong to them. I think that is the higher consciousness I am talking about. Thank you.
One quick question before we ask the audience. You, are there any more time? Any time for any questions? Yeah, that's what my, he's doing something important called Chinayan.
Okay. When the murder of Dr. Dabolkar took place, I felt sad. Dr. Comrade Pansare was killed, I felt furious. When Dr. Kalburgi was killed, I expected that Sahitya Academy would respond to his murder, because he had a Sahitya Academy award, and express grief and shock. That did not happen the way it should have happened. And therefore, I thought I should return my award to Sahitya Academy. I had nothing to do with the government. Actually, the state is empty today. Wo bahut khokhla ho gaya state. Kitna bhi wahan se chilla hai, whether Red Fort or I mean where, the state can do nothing, does nothing except for but writers can. Writers return their awards. Many writers return. I was one. At that time, the propaganda machinery, as Subha, somebody was saying AK-47 or whatever, so our whatever the cryptic name is, that machinery started saying this is all linked to the Bihar elections. My returning the award to Sahitya Academy in Delhi was not linked to the Bihar elections. My interest in Bihar is in relation to the languages of Bihar, but not which party. So I said I will make a visit to the family of Dabolkar, family of Pansare and family of Kalburgi. So with writers from Gujarat, you know, Gujarat also has some great writers. Gujarat used to have a man called Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. He was a Gujarat. So he has taught me that rush there. So we rushed there, and many friends from the writers from Bombay, Pune, Kolhapur, Dharwad joined. They came from Goa all the way to Dharwad, and all of them said, let's meet again. So we met at Dandi, and at Dandi they said, let's meet again. So we met at Goa once again. All this going south became Dakshinayan. The word Dakshinayan means, in the original sense, Sanskrit sense, time of the year when the nights are long and the days are short. But implicit in that dictionary definition is the idea that the time comes when the days become longer, nights become shorter. So you wait for it. The other is, you know, globally, I have a greater sense of belonging to the global south rather than to the global west. So Dakshin is south. And I was physically going south. Also, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, Karnataka are very interesting space, because they are between the, in a way, inconvertible and already converted politically. So I thought to work in these four states, a movement of writers. Now we are meeting in Nagpur and talk to young people on 30th January. And all Ambedkarites, all Gandhians will come there at Vardha Ashram. On 29th and 30th, we go to Diksha Bhumi, where Dr. Ambedkar change over to Buddhism. So that is Dakshina, and it's a movement of fearlessness and truthfulness. Fearlessness and truthfulness, nothing more than that. Just, courage and truth, simple, two simple words. But eventually, I want Dakshinayan to be transformed into a vast open university. A multi, not university, but multiversity, which will work on issues which normal universities do not work on, and it will spread from Ahmedabad down to your own sweet home, Bangalore. So Ahmedabad to Bangalore, and every writer involved in the Dakshinayan movement will become an honorary professor. There is no remuneration, so honorary professor there. And do as in Gandhian times, people spun, khadi or took up sword. Now we are in knowledge century, and the only weapon to counter falsehood, trolling, post-truth is by cultivating knowledge in a consensus way. So I want to initiate this new open university, not degree giving. Not degree, but dignity giving. Dignity giving, open university, a multiversity of the people. So just as the linguistic survey was called the People's Linguistic Survey of India, this will be Dakshinayan, which is a people's multiversity for truth and fearlessness.
Thank you.